of connecting. A couple weeks ago, several weeks ago, we talked first about what it means to grow in the Lord, or actually to serve, and we looked at the story of Jesus washing the disciples' feet, and we're talking about what does it mean to be all in, and that was a picture of what it means to take servanthood seriously. By following the example of Jesus when he washed the disciples' feet and he served the very ones who should be serving him. And he demonstrated that all the way to the point of the cross and dying on the cross for us, the ultimate act of service. We talked about Jesus did not come to be served, but to serve. And as disciples of Jesus Christ, that is a beautiful picture of what it means to be all in, is serving one another. Little ways, big ways, according to your giftedness, according to a need that needs to be met, where you step into that need. Serving. And then we talked about growing. We looked at that story of Mary and Martha, and how Martha was always busy taking care of the little things, preoccupied, and Mary sat at the feet of Jesus listening, and Martha criticized her sister to Jesus and said, "Jesus, you need to tell Mary to start getting busy. I'm cleaning the house, I'm doing all the vacuuming, I'm trying to cook at the same time, and I'm sweeping off the front porch." And Jesus said, "No, Martha, Mary's okay. She's doing the one thing that's needed at this time, the most important thing, and that is she's sitting at my feet, listening and learning from me." It's a picture of what it means to be all in, is for us to be humbly at Jesus' feet, learning, listening, loving, putting Him first, growing in our relationship with Him. And now today, I want us to talk about this whole idea of what does it mean to be all in terms of connecting with one another. Regardless of what fellowship or church that you're a part of, or maybe even what organization you're a part of. Toastmasters, Tapestry, Women's Group, Cancer Small Group, or Encouragement Group, whatever you're a part of, what does it mean to be all in that organization or that fellowship? Somebody just give me something off the top of your head. When you think about what does it mean to be committed, to be all in to the group that you are connected to?
Support each other.
Good. Can you give me an example of, maybe just one example of how we might do that?
Sure. If somebody doesn't come to the senior center, somebody will call.
Good.
Find out if they're ill.
Good. Only to find out that it's because the senior center raised the rates that they didn't come. Something else. What does it mean for you to be all in with the group or organization that you are a part of?
Be available.
Available?
Yeah. Just let people know that they can count on you and be available for them if they need something.
Good. Very good. Javier, what does it mean to be all in the military one weekend a month?
A lot. Well, we work together as a team with the little chance we get once a month. Team play, we're team players.
Right.
So we help each other.
So let me ask you a little more on that. You have a role to play in the team.
Yes.
You have an AFSC. If you don't show up and do your role, does it affect the team?
It does, yes.
Yeah. Affects the team. It affects us every week in Toastmasters when we get a no-show, no-call.
Show up.
Yes, show up. There's nothing worse than being the Toastmaster leader. And somebody doesn't show, doesn't call, and they're supposed to have a role, and the team suffers because of it. That's another thing, being all in, for sure. Talisa. Yes, and just so you know, Crystal, there have been many conversations where I said, Well, maybe you can just take that Tuesday of Tapestry off. No, I can't. That's my priority. Everything else revolves around that. I'm committed to that. That's what my role is. I need to be committed to that. Well, we can go and do this, and you can have somebody up. No. I'm committed. And even to find out when she's not going to be there, like last week, what did she do? She called Nadara, said, Nadara, I need you to step into this role and take care of this so that when she's not there, there's not a vacuum. Definitely something else. What it means to be all in when we're part of something. And I'm asking these ideas because there's a lot of overlap and similarities when it comes to being all in the local fellowship of a church. Because we all have a role. We all play a part in the body. We're a hand or an eye or a foot. When the hand isn't there, it affects the whole body. When the eye isn't there, we can't see as well. When the foot isn't there, we can't walk as well. Because it's hard to walk on one foot. What are the dynamics then? Why do we need each other? What does it mean to be all in and be connected with whatever we're a part of? Can I have a reader for this, please? Crystal, you want to read that for us nice and loud?
Some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a mat and tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. When they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on his mat through the tiles into the middle of the crowd, right in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." The Pharisees and the teachers of the law began thinking to themselves, "Who is this fellow who speaks blasphemy? Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Jesus knew what they were thinking and asked, "Why? Are you thinking these things in your hearts? Which is easier to say, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up and walk'? But I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." So he said to the paralyzed man, "I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home." Immediately he stood up in front of them, took what he had been lying on, and went home praising God.
All right, thank you. Initial thoughts about this story. Can you visualize it? Try and get this in your head of what this looked like. Some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a mat and tried to take him into the house before Jesus. Let's stop right there. I'm guessing four people, but I don't know for sure. Probably four, one on each corner, carrying this guy. Is that what you would assume? I haven't been able to find it in the commentary. They're carrying this mat. They're trying to get into the house because this man is paralyzed. And if we can just get this man to Jesus, he maybe get healed. Because we've heard about Jesus, we've seen Jesus, we know what he can do. And they wanted to just lay him before Jesus when they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd. But they couldn't get to Jesus. This is not unusual for a big crowd to be gathered around Jesus and the person. There's one story about Zacchaeus. You remember that one? He couldn't get to Jesus either. So you know what he did for creativity? What did he do, James? Yeah, he said, "Oh, that's no problem. I'll get creative." He climbed the sycamore tree. And he's hanging out over the limb as Jesus is walking by in the crowd. "Hello, Jesus. Hi, I'm Zacchaeus here." He got to him one way or another. And they can't get to Jesus because the crowd is too big. But yet, these people carrying the mat. Let's think about them for a second. What would life have been like if this man had nobody to carry the mat for him and take him to Jesus? He wasn't part of a community, wasn't part of a spiritual family. We're going to find out in a second the deficit that we run when we're not connected to one another. But in this case, fortunately, he had a few people in his life who cared enough about him to say, "Hey, we'll do what it takes to help you, to love you, to get you to Jesus. We're going to take you there. We're going to help you get there." The crowd is too big. So what did they do? They got creative. They didn't climb a tree. What does the story tell us happened? Yeah, and it's kind of a ladder, kind of stairs that go, from my understanding, that went up on top of the house. And it wasn't brick and mortar houses like we have. More of a straw hay type thing, maybe mud. And they created a hole in the roof, desperate to to get this person to Jesus. The crowd's too big. We'll get him to you, and then we will lower him. And there's no way Jesus can ignore this. He's going to have to deal. He's going to have to deal with a man being lowered on a mat. So I don't know if they had ropes that they tied to each four corners, and they all took a rope and kind of lowered him down. But here's Jesus teaching a lesson, talking about the principles of the kingdom, and all of a sudden here comes this mat with a man on it coming down from the roof, and everybody's watching it going, what the heck? Who is this guy? And another question, who in the world would care enough about this guy to be so desperate that they would go up and create a hole in the roof just to lower this guy to get to Jesus? Somebody, he's connected somehow, some way, to have some people who care about him like that. We all need to have a few people that care about us, and we need to have a few people that we care about enough to want to take them to the one who can heal them. Take them to the one like Wes did this week at Cabela's. Wes didn't miss that opportunity. But he took the fish and reels in, and as he was working with reels and talking about flies, he got a little message of the gospel in there and shared his faith, which I think is just awesome. They lowered him on a mat, threw him in tiles, I guess, here, into the middle of the crowd right in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." We're going to talk about that in a second. But let's go to this for right now. We all need to be carried to Jesus at one time or another. If you have your little sermon book, you can write that in there. We all need to be carried to Jesus at one time or another, because you're going to have a need in your life. It may be physical, it may be emotional, your marriage may be on the rocks, your kid may be acting out and getting in trouble at school, you may have someone in your family pass away, you may have a personal issue that is weighing you down, and you're gonna be the person on the mat at some point in your life. And if you haven't been the person on the mat yet, you will be. And when that time happens, see, life is great until we're on the mat. Because we're in control, life is good, I'm healthy, everything's clicking, I got a job, I'm getting paid, everything's going all right with my family, there's no major barriers, nothing's falling apart with my car in the last 2 weeks, everything's just kind of going okay, the shingles are still fairly on my house, at least for now, life is pretty good. But then the shingles start to fall off. Something happens in the marriage that puts you through a trial. When you get a call from the principal saying your kid is acting out. You get a neighbor of a house you own that calls and says, this happened or that happened, now you gotta go take care of it. And you'll find yourself on the mat. That's when you need to be really, really grateful that you have a few people who can carry you. Right now, Cheryl Diaz, Mario's wife, is on the mat. She's on the mat with all that's happening to her with cancer. But thank God, she's part of a fellowship where we can all grab a corner and say, we're trusting God for you. We're believing God for you. We want you to have hope because we've seen God work in so many situations. And we're going to encourage her, we're going to carry her, and we're going to lift her to Jesus during this time. We're going to walk with her. But maybe you will be the next one on the mat. And when you're connected, it provides an opportunity for other people to help you, which is very humbling sometimes. Because it's a lot easier to help other people than it is sometimes to let other people help us. Because it takes humility to let other people speak into our lives. It takes humility to let other people carry us. And some of us are getting heavier all the time, so we're not easy to carry. We all need to be carried, and that's what they did. They carried the paralyzed man. And that's the benefit that we get by being connected to a fellowship, because we can pray for each other. We can carry each other's burdens. We can show up and help you move if you need some furniture moved. We can be a blessing in some way. We can help emotionally. We can just be there for each other. We can do ministry together. We can share vegetables with each other. We can loan a trailer to the church for them to use when they need one. We can do our part. That's all the benefit. But if we're not connected, and we don't have any people in our lives, we've got no one to carry the mat when we need it. And we're not there to carry the mat for somebody else who's paralyzed and needs us, because we're just off doing our own thing. And that's what's so beautiful about being connected. It challenges us both ways. When we're on the mat, we need to let other people help us, and then we need to be there for other people when they need the help. We need a spiritual family for two reasons: to be carried to Jesus and to help carry others to Jesus. I just said that. Life without a spiritual family can be very hard. And I'll say, as a pastor and a chaplain, that sometimes people will transition away from church, their spiritual family, away from God, maybe. And I would say almost every single time that happens, and they may have a million excuses for it, I have seen parallel to their decision to step away from church and be connected, I've also seen a devolving experience in their personal life as well. It seems like they go together. And the minute we take ourselves out of fellowship, it seems like other things in our lives start falling apart too. I don't know why that is, but it just seems that way. I've seen it over and over again with people who say, well, you know, I'm just going to take a break from being part of a fellowship. I'm just going to take a break from church. And in doing that, often, it's not nothing wrong with taking a break, but in doing that, oftentimes, they just get further and further away from the Lord. They just get further and further away from caring about other people. They get further, we get to become more self-absorbed. That's why Jesus says so many times, it's all about loving Him and loving one another. Serving one another, sharing, praying for one another, encouraging one another. Just like you guys do at the senior center when somebody's not there. Or if somebody comes in and says, hey, I learned something about my health this week. You can all care and be support to that person. Anybody have anything to say at this point? Anything to share? Now listen to this, watch this. Here's an example of the consequences if we're not connected. Sherry, will you read this for us?
Now a certain man was there who had infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he already had been in that condition a long time, he said to him, do you want to be made well? The sick man answered him, sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, others step down before me.
So here's this paralyzed man, and the story, you can read more on it in John 5, it's the pool of Bethesda, and it's this healing pool. And whenever the water would get stirred up, for whatever reason, the first person to get into the stirred up water would receive physical healing. But this paralyzed, this man with the infirmity of 38 years, when Jesus saw him sitting there, he said to Jesus, I can't mobilize myself. So every time the water stirred up, I'm never the first one in the water to get healed. Other people go in before me. And the reason why, he said, is because, why? Why was he never the first one in?
He didn't have anybody to back him up.
Nobody to help him. Nobody to carry the mat for him. Nobody to carry the mat. And so he couldn't receive the healing that he needed, because he didn't have any friends. He didn't have anybody to care. He didn't have anybody that he was connected to. And that's the reality of what it means to try and go solo and try and live without connections in our lives. Because we really can't do it. People need us and we need people. And that's just so forcefully That picture is painted so forcefully in the scriptures, both Old and New Testament. Am I my brother's keeper? Kind of. Yeah, kind of are. The sick man answered, I have no one to put me in the pool when the water is stirred up. So Jesus himself touched the man. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. And I wanted to put this in here, pay special attention to that last line. We all know that we have our personal families, our immediate families, spouses, kids. Those are our immediate families. Then we have family outside of that, brothers, sisters, siblings, parents. We have relatives. And then the concentric circles continue after that. Then we have acquaintances. We have friends. We have acquaintances. Then we have the world at large. But in those circles of connection that we have, look at what Jesus says. Look at what Paul says. Paul says, as you have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. It's interesting to me. It's interesting because you might think Jesus would say it all starts at home. Just make sure you take care of your kids at home. Obviously, we should do that. That is the number one primary responsibility. But there's something about the fellowship of believers. There's something about the church, the family of believers, that becomes the laboratory for caring for others. So the laboratory where we learn how to really care for family, the world, the people at the senior center, the other ladies in tapestry, the other motorcycle riders that go on motorcycle rides with, the laboratory for that, the place where we get to practice that is the family of believers, which is awesome why we have a table of eight. Because Sherry and Wes, this time, before it was at Crystal's house, that's one way, and a great way, is it not, to say, hey, we care about you. And we want to get to know you, we want to have fellowship together. It's not the only way, but it's a great way. So I'm telling you today, don't be discouraged that we're not a church of 1,000 or 500. Don't be discouraged at all. Be encouraged that we're small enough to where if you have a need, three or four of us from this fellowship can take up a corner. Because that's really what we need in life. It's not how many people we have, how many friends we have, it's that we, do we have a few friends who really care? My wife has a saying, what is it when it comes to quantity versus quality of friends? Make a bigger impact on a few people than making a small impact on many. I like that. That's really good. Secondly, in a spiritual family, we share the same hope and the same person. And this is what makes us unique as a church. Why is our group or fellowship any different than a group of guys meeting at the bar? You can have good fellowship at the bar. You have good conversation. You can talk about each other's lives. What makes this different? What makes this different than the fellowship that takes place otherwise? The Fly Fishing Club, you guys have good fellowship there, I'm sure, Wes. You guys tell fish stories. And the first flyer never has a chance. It's always the second and the third one that gets the biggest story. Here's what's different about the family of believers that we can't find in other organizations, is that we gather for a purpose to lift up one person and put our hope in him, and that's Jesus. Jesus is the one, and we see this in this story. They wanted to bring Jesus not just to the Kiwanis, they wanted to bring this paralyzed man not to the Kiwanis Club, not to a Toastmasters meeting, not to a senior event, not to a self-help organization. They wanted to take this man to Jesus because Jesus is the one who can forgive sins. And I want to continue to encourage us. Not that Jesus has excluded himself to church, because he certainly hasn't, but this is sure one of the places where we get to carry the mat for people to to take them to this place where they get introduced to Jesus and hear stories about him. And that's what happened. So here's Jesus. He's the one who can forgive sins, not us. So we got to carry the mat to take people. And the least we can do is say to a person, have you ever opened up your heart to pray about this? Have you ever asked God maybe what he wants you to do? We just had a discussion with a couple yesterday, and Talisa got around to asking the question, have you ever prayed about it? Have you ever asked God what he wants you to do? It's a pretty good question to ask. They took him, and then Jesus saw their faith, and he said, friend, your sins are forgiven. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law began thinking to themselves, who is this fellow Jesus who speaks blasphemy? Who can forgive sins but God alone? See, they knew in their head, nobody can forgive sins but God alone. So if this person called Jesus is saying he can forgive sins, what kind of assumption does that make about him? Okay, I'll say it again. So, they knew that if God was the only one who could forgive sins, and Jesus was saying, offering forgiveness, so what did that mean Jesus must be? He must be God. He's saying he's God. And that's blasphemy. Nobody can claim to be God except God. Unless he really was God. Then that's a whole different story. And we know that he was. It's a very Trinitarian verse right here, actually. Jesus saw their faith and Jesus offered forgiveness. That's why we carry the mat and put people in the direction of Jesus. Because he alone is the one who can forgive sins and heal. Jesus is the one with the power to heal. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law began thinking to themselves, who is this fellow who speaks blasphemy, who can forgive sins? Jesus knew what they were thinking, and he asked them, why are you thinking these things in your heart? Which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven, or to say get up and walk? Which do you think is easier? Which is easier to say to a paralyzed man, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and walk? Pretty easy to say, your sins are forgiven, because you don't have to prove it. You can just say it. And there's no validation of it. You don't have to validate it. It's easy to tell someone your sins are forgiven. And then Jesus says, but I want you to know that the Son of Man, speaking of himself, has authority to forgive sins. So I'm going to prove to you. So he said to the paralyzed man, I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home, which was validation for the words that he spoke. Because it's easy to say your sins are forgiven. It's much harder to tell a paralyzed man to get up and walk. So if a paralyzed man can get up and walk, it validates the authority I have to forgive sins. Guess what? Immediately he stood up, took what he'd been lying on, and went home praising God. A paralyzed man being healed in front of their very eyes. And what did that validate to those Pharisees and teachers of law? What message did that send when that happened?
He is God.
He is God. He can forgive sins. Because we know this man. He's paralyzed. He can't walk. That's what it proved. Everyone was amazed and gave praise to God. They were filled with awe and said, we have seen remarkable things today. So when it comes to us being connected to one another, know this. I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for all people. This comes from Timothy. When we're connected and we know about your need, we can help pray for you. We can shoulder the burden. If you're not connected and nobody knows, they can't help you. And we get to help somebody else when they have a need. That's really cool. That's what it means to be part, at least partially, of the family of believers and the benefits of being connected spiritually. So as we close today, we're going to continue to pray for Cheryl. Is there anybody else who has a prayer need today? And you say, you know, I just got something in my life. Can you pray for me regarding this? And you will allow us to carry your burden with you. Anything? You don't have to make it up. Just sit sometimes lay there. Okay. Anybody have any thoughts as we kind of come into our closing time here? Does this trigger any thoughts in you? Barbara, you have any thoughts about this?
I
Fargo today and her daughter. We don't know all the needs, but it sounds like it's important. Sounds like it's serious. Okay. Anyone else? All right. Oh, Patty, please.
Well, I just wanted, it mentions Thanksgiving, so I've just been really thankful to see Evan growing and learning and developing so quickly. He just amazes us every day with all the things that he's doing and learning, and the little person he's turned into. We're just very, very thankful for that.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. May God continue to bless him as he develops. So that you can have a dry humor in my coffee here.
That's a lesson.
You guys don't know about Gary yet. You ever get him alone, listen to him crack some jokes. I mean, he's a funny guy. Maybe you know him. Just gotta get him. You gotta see him in action. You can see him at work sometime. All right, well, let's offer a quick word of prayer for that, please. And Thanksgiving. Sherry, would you mind praying for Cheryl? And let's see, Crystal, would you pray for Barbara and her daughter?
Sure.
And then, let's see, James, would you pray in Thanksgiving for Evan and how he's doing? All right, let's pray.
Dear Jesus, we want to thank you for bringing us all here together and we have a special prayer request for Cheryl. She has been with us since the beginning and has given so much to this little church, and now we need to give to her, help her get through this, I can't even imagine, trying situation that she's in, and for all her family, that they will be there for her when she actually needs some help at home.
God, we just come to you and we lift Barbara and her daughter up to you, and you know the prayer needs, but we just ask that you show your love and support and use us in any way that you see fit, and we just pray for your arms to be wrapped around Barbara and her daughter, and that you answer all of Barbara's prayers in your will, God, and we just thank you for the opportunity to serve Barbara and to pray for her and her daughter, and just thank you for her heart, and we just pray that the Holy Spirit fills up Barbara so that she can be the light and the love that you are requiring her to be through this time. We just thank you for all that you are doing.
Lord, we thank you. You are such an amazing and awesome creator. We're just in awe of the things that you do in our lives, the blessings that you bring into our lives, and the children that you create and that you give us stewardship over. Just thank you so much for the blessing of Evan, Javier, and Patty, that you've maybe with the family and help them grow together and protect Evan as he gets larger and larger and develops a new young man. We just thank you for the children that you bless on this earth.
We pray this in Jesus' name, and everyone said,
Amen.
Now may God the Father and God the Son and God the Spirit, the powerful Son of Man, Jesus, God, give you peace and joy and forgiveness. And everyone said,
Amen.
Amen again. Thank you very much. We're going to forego communion today, and we're going to forego our song.
You've already got it.
You've already got it. Let's go ahead and eat today. Do I have one?
She wouldn't leave you out.
Still on Hawaiian time, huh?
I'm still on Hawaiian time. Praise Jesus. Lord, thank you for that we can pray to you with everything, our petitions, our thanksgiving, our hurts, our needs, knowing that you hear us. Thank you for your brokenness. We thank you. Let's eat together. Jesus said, this is my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Thank you for that scripture today that reminds us, who on earth can forgive sins but God? But you, Jesus, you alone, and that's what you want to do. Please forgive us, wash us, cleanse us anew, afresh today by the power of your Holy Spirit and your cleansing love. May it wash through us as we drink together. Now bless each one of us this week as we go our own way. Help us be that voice like Wes was this week. Help us to be that light in a dark place. Help us to be that encouragement. Help us to take time to pray for the needs that we have. Help us to take time to sit at your feet and to put you first this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Please take some vegetables on your way out.